Good morning, good morning. I am back. I am back with, I like men around me. Let's have them introduce themselves.
Good morning, good morning. Chris Summerall, public servant and entrepreneur in the city of Detroit.
Alice Liddell, committed entrepreneur, just like Chris, owns ELE Wealth Management.
Darone Buffington, business development manager for Michigan Community VNA.
Wow. All these prosperous men, but we're going to get into, I can't wait to get into the column by Bankole Thompson, because it kind of, it hit home. Now, you have a daughter. You don't have, yeah,
yes,
you have
yes,
kids.
Yes,
you
do,
have any boys?
I have two boys.
Okay, and I have a boy.
Then two girls, let me say that.
I have a brother. a brother.
We all got nieces, nephews, and,
right.
You know.
Yeah. But this is something. Yeah, I kind of go back on. But anyway, let's talk real quick on DACA. DACA, of course, is that act that kept children of illegal aliens in the country so that they could work and go to school and so forth, because they came over here at no insistence of their own. Their parents brought them. And Donald Trump says, well, he's going to put an end to that program. And that Barack Obama started, but Barack Obama did say it was temporary. But people got afraid right away. They said 6 months, he gives you 6 months. And now he's saying, well, don't worry about it. What do you all think?
Well, he almost backtracked immediately.
Almost, yes.
He almost backtracked immediately. I think it's it undermines what America is about. You know, the land of the free, the land to pursue your dreams. And you have children that were brought over here by their parents to give them a better life in this country. And basically you're saying, no, we're not going to allow you that better life. Get out. When this country was founded on immigration, basically.
Yeah, and I think probably one of the most significant points was that there was promises made under the Obama administration, right, which many of these folks were very, very fearful about coming out of the dark, about, you know, being over here, so to speak. And so there was promises, there was assurances that things would be held a certain way. And so what you're seeing is a stark contrast in ideology, but also in function between the two administrations. So I think that is what is so, you know, there isn't a transition. It's kind of like President Obama's administration was headed in one way, and the Trump administration is heading the exact opposite way.
Well, I think opposite is the word for Trump as far as Obama is concerned, because he's trying to cut down everything that Obama enforced, don't you think?
Let me give you my take on this.
I was waiting for your take.
I know, you saved me for last. But let me give you my take on it. President Trump has gotten his butt kicked. The only good day he had was probably that night that he won everything. After that, he's been getting his butt kicked. So he decided, you know what? This legislation is going to expire under my term. I might as well bring this out right now. So I see this as him throwing a Hail Mary. He threw a political football in the air, and he says, let's just watch and see who's going to pull it down and carry this. Because he threw it to Congress. And if Congress doesn't make this permanent, Obama's program, permanent, then everybody's going to blame Congress. And he did it now because of the election cycle that's coming up. So he did exactly, he wanted to take the heat off of him. You know, between Russia and all the other things, and his son's got to testify, he needed to throw the football out and say, wait a minute, hold guys. I don't get to do this. I can sign another executive order, but it's going to be temporary. Congress gets to vote this into law. So that's his interpretation, is that he wants to take the attention off of him and put it on Congress.
I think he wants to take it off of him. I think he's willing to almost start a war to take it off of him, because he knows, like somebody said, what is he afraid of? So I think he's piling all of these things up. There's a lot going on. How is Congress even going to function with so much that they have going on? The Russia investigation, Korea, and this, and just a host of other things. And I just want to say, there was something you just said that, oh, he's being slick about it. I think, too, he's playing to his base. That's very important.
You know what? I think he's about, when you get on the airplane, the first thing they tell you is to put the oxygen, in the case of emergency, put the mask on yourself before assisting others. I don't think Trump's about assisting anybody else. This is about Trump and distraction. Yes, he wrote the book called The Art of the Deal, but no one talks about his other thing that he's good at, which is the art of distraction.
Oh, yeah. I put that on my post the other day. I think all this stuff is a distraction. Yeah.
And I think that the timing.
Oh, he was okay. Go ahead. Say something. Go ahead.
I was just going to say they tried something like this in California not too long ago with a proposition, and it nearly killed the Republican Party out there because they had so many Latinos that were illegal immigrants that were working and things of that sort. It really, really came back to haunt them. And I'm thinking with him throwing this out there and elections coming up next year for. You know, House of Representatives, Senators, it puts them in a very precarious situation. And if they do not act and vote the right way, I think we could be seeing a lot of change.
Chris?
And I was going to just talk on the timing. When we were looking at what's going on specifically south of the United States, there's a barrage. Even in the areas that are heavily populated with immigrant folks, right? We're seeing folks who are going through a lot right now, right? So the timing is of compassion for these people, right? For these individuals. And so now to put this on top, so we're going to throw these people back to where it's devastated. Not only are we going to, you know, take the promise of possibility and things like that away, but we're going to throw you right back to where it's super devastated, no infrastructure, the economy is third world, you know. So I think the timing on this, as well as to the sensitivity of it, and I just think that, you know, again, this is something that involves people's lives, right? It's legislation, but it's actually people's lives.
And you have to look at it from a compassionate standpoint where these are kids.
Correct.
You know, a lot of them are kids. So these kids
but
have been raised as Americans.
But he corrected that and said, well, they've grown up.
Not all of them.
I know.
I just saw a story the other day in regards to a young lady that graduated from Cass Tech that is now a student at University of Michigan. And she had been an honor student, had done everything basically that you would want your child to do in regards to excelling and trying to exceed. And now this comes at her where she might be sent back to whatever nation she was from. And she's never been there. She doesn't know anything about it. That hasn't been her life. Her life has been lived as an American. Mm-hmm. So, you know, that's pretty traumatic.
Well, Ellis, don't you think that part and parcel, he made some of these announcements Friday night when he knew that people would be, and he said it, he knew people would be watching television. He knew the ratings would be up. It just bordered on cruelty to me.
He threw a Hail Mary.
Yeah, okay.
When you throw a Hail Mary, you
hope
care
it's
about,
gonna work.
Right. It worked from his perspective. You don't care about anybody else on your team. You throw the ball down and you say, which one of you guys want to be a superhero and catch this ball? And you're going to have 10 other people trying to
Calvin
tackle
Johnson.
You're going to catch this ball.
But it also gives the other team a chance
to
intercept it. And I think he's thrown a Hail Mary. But there's so many different things at stake with the outcome of this Hail Mary.
Which one's going to step up, the Democratic Party or the Republican Party? Because keep in mind, Trump's the president. He doesn't have a party.
Right.
He doesn't anymore.
No, he really doesn't. He has hung the Republicans out to dry in a way. I think.
And guess what? If a Democrat or Republican steps up to get this passed, who gets credit for it? Trump. He gets to look good.
Yeah.
Takes the pressure off himself.
Yeah, but it's just so psycho because he's sitting up now telling them, don't worry about it. He's telling the dreamers, don't worry about it. We're okay.
Yeah,
you'll be okay.
What announcement did he make in the middle of Hurricane Harvey? He doesn't care about emotions and people. He just does what he, you know, takes advantage of opportunities.
And I think part of that is his aloofness or disconnect with the day-to-day people and the emotional cycle of those folks, right? So if you can't relate to the folks that this will impact, or if you can't relate to the life that they live, then you don't really understand. So there's just a huge disconnect. And he, more than probably any other person, probably because of the platform that he has, just shows how disconnected the highest office in the world is with everyday people.
And I'd like to go back to something that you said before in regards, you know, a lot of the immigrants, especially in Texas, Florida, they're being hit really hard right now.
Now in California with the tsunami earthquake this morning that will...
Yeah.
Was that in California?
Well, it's in Mexico, but the, you know, it's definitely affecting the whole West Coast.
You know, with all of that happening, and basically... His position is, here, let me throw something else on your plate for you to deal with at this time. It's really, really troubling because you see kind of the country coming back together, galvanizing, saying, hey, let's support these victims of this hurricane or that hurricane. And then in the middle of it, he says, well, why are you all at it? You might need to get them a plane ticket or a bus ticket because they're getting out of here. And that's, I mean, it shows no compassion. It shows no empathy. It shows a total lack of respect, basically, for our country. That's what I look at it, because this country was basically found on immigration. You know, mostly everybody came from somewhere else.
Right.
And
right.
You know, that's what was promised.
Didn't somebody, your father, come from a different?
Yeah, my grandfather came here illegally from Cuba, and was eventually deported back there. Because of some things or whatever. So, I mean, under that premise, if maybe Trump was president then, you know, me and my brothers and sisters that, you know, you guys know, we'd probably not be here.
Oh, man.
Ms. Perriman, you heard the expression, misery loves company.
Yeah.
Trump is in the middle of a miserable presidential campaign. Presidential term. I mean, he got to be one of the most miserable presidents.
They say it's the worst ever.
There you go. So, misery loves company. He just say, you know what, I'm not going to be the only one suffering.
Right.
But it's crazy when you look at the news and you look at different things on the internet and you see the responses to some of these articles. And it's like the thoughts that we're having up here are totally opposite of what I see in those responses. And they aren't from people that look like us. So, somebody is supporting him. Somebody thinks he's doing a good job, and it's really troubling that, you know, part of America feels this way.
Hey, let him wait a little longer. He'll step on every toe in America before he's done.
Every toe?
Every toe in America. And he's going to step on a few feet while he's at it.
Well, I was telling the story last hour on another segment how my professor told me in 1971, 72, when I was working on my master's, about the fear that would be coming starting around 2000 or before, because they knew that this country was going to be majority minority, and how people will start the covert racism will become overt, and it has become overt.
Yeah. Hey, who were the first people in this country?
Well, I think it was the Indians
or Native Americans, right?
Right.
And what did what did they do to Native Americans? They put them on reservations.
Yes,
right?
They did.
So. Once we become a threat, it's war. And we're living in the midst of war.
I agree.
All of his legislation has been against immigration so far.
Well, in one way or another. I think some things are going to come up that are going to hurt the poor, very much so.
Oh, absolutely. You know, a very sobering thought is that there's a large amount of people that agree with him. And while we can speak on him in an isolated, using his name, President Trump, whatever, he represents a very large, large amount of people who identify and even champion, if not him, the spirit that he reflects. And so when you dare read the comments under these articles, you're reminded that it goes even further than that, right? He's mild compared to many of the responses, and with the advent of obviously the internet and people hiding behind, you know, social media or whatever like that, you really see what's in people's hearts, and it's absolutely terrifying when you think, like, are people really that evil? You know, or, and obviously morality is subjective.
And misguided.
And misguided. And so, you know, we'll see. But again, it's going to be interesting to see how it plays out.
People just, in general, society is kind of mediocre, and they do not, a lot of people do not think critically. They don't go past what, say, if Ellis says something, I listen to Ellis, but I said, I got to check this out a little more. Right. You know, you should do that, but a lot of people don't do that.
Yeah, they don't fact check. They rely on, hey, if it was on TV, it must be true.
Mm-hmm. If Trump said it, it's the truth.
Or even now, with the conversation, if the media speaks on it, it must be a lie, right? Because he's undermined the credibility of the media. Yeah, so right, yes. If there's a point there, oh, well, that must, I got to go look all the way over here because that's obviously not true. So it's kind of, I mean, to the defensive people, they don't know which way is up, right? Because, you know, there's this 360, folks are dizzy as far as consciously. You know, do I listen to the media? Do I trust the internet? Do I listen to my president? You know, and so what it boils back down to me personally is you have to have a moral compass personally, right? Because for many, they lean upon these compasses to give them direction. But if you don't have your compass set personally, you're lost right about now.
And common sense.
Absolutely. Well, I always wonder, what can we do about it? So that's something I just like to always think about. What can I do about it?
For the single people, marry an immigrant.
You got announcements you want to make, Chris? Seen it?
Oh, anyway, let's go to our next one. It was a column by Bankole Thompson, Black Boys, Toys, and Deadly Police Encounters. And I'd just like to read the first paragraph so everyone will know about it, and then we'll talk about it. A year ago at a meeting of the Grosse Pointe Harper Woods chapter of the NAACP on media coverage of racial justice issues, some members of the audience, people of color as well as a number of whites, shared with me that more whites, especially those from suburban communities, need to speak out when children die in police situations in urban or rural settings, regardless of skin color. And I'm just going to read on just a little more. We had been discussing the story of 12-year-old Tamir Rice of Cleveland, who was fatally shot by police in 2014 while holding a toy gun, and that of other boys whose lives have been cut short in police encounters. Because, let's face it, these boys could have been the audience members' sons or nephews. This, he's talking about this because I believe it was last week a young man was riding an ATV, which is illegal to drive in the city, isn't it?
On the street.
And he was tased by a state police trooper, and he ended up having an accident and was killed.
Yeah, let's paint the picture a little bit more better for everyone. He was tased by an officer out of his car. It was as if it was the old days of slavery, and it was running to look for
a runaway slave.
And he had a lasso, and he's roping around, so he's throwing out to try to get him. So he took his taser while the other guy's driving the car, and he gets over close to him, and he shoots him from his car to the ATV. And everyone knows that if you get tased, what happens to people who get tased? They usually go down because it knocks them out.
Right.
So he had no care for life, shot out of the window, hit this young man. He did exactly what was supposed to happen. His body went numb, had an accident, killed himself.
He was murdered
as a result of being paralyzed so that he couldn't defend himself.
Absolutely. Comments?
It was very disheartening when I read it, as well as the Tamir Rice, because I put myself in that situation. Especially with the Tamir Rice, you know, kids playing with toy guns. You know, as a child, we used to play cops and robbers. We used to play cowboys and Indians, games like that. And we had, you know, toy guns and things of that sort. And I can remember being 12 years old. You know, that child was at a playground doing what a child was supposed to do, play. And, you know, the police pulled up without any discretion and shot him. When I looked at the video, I could see that he was a child, It didn't look like he was a man. It didn't even look like he was a teenager. He was a child.
Well, I guarantee you that Ellis, Daron, or Chris, you playing with this little toy gun, and we're going to get back to the one issue at hand that happened last week. You all would not have been fired upon as quickly when you were young children. I think the mentality of the police
has changed.
Mm-hmm. It's different. It's different. Mm-hmm. And what you said, this young man was murdered. It was just an ATV.
Yeah.
You know, there were other ways.
He hadn't committed any crime. The only crime that he had committed was riding that ATV
in the street.
On the street, and he did not stop.
And on top of
was he wrong for that? Yes. Was it an offense that he should have been killed for? No. If he was out in the suburbs and you had a white kid riding the ATV, I'm very sure they would not have driven up and tased this young man so that it was a disregard for his life. He could have hit someone else. It was a total disregard for life.
Not to mention he violated every single code that there is as it relates to.
They changed the rule right after that.
They came out and said state troopers are not supposed to interact with residents. Mm-hmm. Let the police department do their job.
Yeah, that's what I didn't understand either.
He had no right or authority to do what he did.
That's what I thought, because some people initially thought it was Detroit police. No, it wasn't. It was the Michigan State Police. Any comments?
You know, I'm personally emotional about this because I'm just so tired. You know, it's and people, if you're not black or minority, you just not gonna understand how this personally affects us, and it's just exhausting. Not only these instances, but that we know how this is gonna unfold, right? You know, and that's why I think the population of the police that perpetrate these actions, they continue to feel confident, right? If the justice system continues to find no fault criminally, then you're giving them the green light. And I'm just tired of doing everything I'm supposed to, right? Everything I'm supposed to, and still being subject at any given moment to harassment, terrorism, and even murder.
Even if you look at the news this week, you know, with Martellus Bennett?
The football player.
Right. Plays for Seattle Seahawks.
What happened?
He was at the Mayweather fight. And someone shot, shot the crowd, ran. He was one of the people in the crowd that was running. Police grabbed him, threw him to the ground.
Put his knee in his back.
Told him he'd blow his head off.
With the gun next to his head.
Yeah. And he's a professional football player. And really, they picked the wrong one. Because he's been one that has been very outspoken in regards to what was going on in our community with police brutality and things of that sort. He's been one of the ones that said he would not stand for the flag. And the crazy thing about it, the Las Vegas Police Department did not issue him an apology. They sent a letter to Commissioner Roger Goodell yesterday saying that they think that he should be suspended or punished because he spoke out on the issue.
And let me just say this here. We won't be naive enough to think that he was not picked out because they know who he was in advance.
Absolutely. Yeah.
So we won't say he was picked randomly.
Well, he could have been. We don't know that.
And he could have been recognized.
But he's a multimillionaire. He's a successful athlete. He's a humanitarian. And that did not Yeah, that did not stop them from seeing him as
targeting him as
a threat.
Yeah.
You know, I used to look at videos and sometimes these podcasts of these extremists, these black extremists, and I'd say, man, this guy's psycho. He thinks that, you know, the government it really hates black people. I don't know.
Well, I never bought my son a toy gun. Never. I just, I just didn't. I didn't want him to even know. Well, of course, he knew, I guess, about gun culture from watching television. I don't know if that ever stopped anything, but I just never felt comfortable getting him a gun, and therefore, they never played cops and robbers at my house.
What about ATV? Could he? See, that's the thing. You like, what is it like? A bicycle or what? I mean, what is it? What do you want? What do you want us like not to do? Because every instance we lay on our back, hands up, bow, you still shot. Like, when is there an instance where? And this is really talking like what other like white folks are gonna say? Yeah, that's jacked up. Because black folks, this is the truth. They don't care about our voice. There's not enough of us, and we don't hold the position to hold the position or the influence to really get them to move their head enough. And so what I'm saying is, when are these other folks going to see that this is not what's up? Every instance
and they're trying to punish you for taking a knee during the national anthem.
There's no accountability.
I mean, it's ridiculous. You're going to think like us, or you're not gonna flourish in this society.
And the fact that they don't believe that it's happening, something that you must have done. I think this country has to get to a point kind of like back in the civil rights, where they had the bombing of the church and the three little girls were killed, where you say, you know what, that's just terrible. Unfortunately, we haven't gotten to that point yet when it comes to police brutality and them overstepping their boundaries. A little boy playing in a park being shot, that hasn't done it.
Well, let me say this right quick. Last week, I was just stunned by the video of that nurse. Did you see
it? Yes, yes.
The nurse who would not take blood from this person who had been in an accident.
That officer was fired.
Good, because I just heard he was just taken off. How dare he? He dragged her out, handcuffed her. I mean, threw her to a wall. Is this the mentality that's going on? Is this the kind of person that they hire in police departments?
I look at that differently, though. My man got fired for throwing a nurse in cuffs and putting in a car, but there's other cops that didn't kill black kids. They get administrative leave, paid, and are back on the job. That disparity is crazy.
Or
white woman crying, "Oh my God!" And I'm not minimizing that, but it's people dying. Yes, right. That was traumatic to get handcuffed and embarrassed and put in that car. But more happened to an officer for doing that than murdering an innocent young black child
on tape.
That's not what. But the point I'm just trying to make is the mentality, the moral fortitude or lack of, therefore, of it to be able to. Who do you think you are?
Well,
that's the basic thing.
When I saw that, I had hope at that point that, hey, they're doing it to a white woman. Something's going to get done now. Because I look at white women as being the ultimate victims. You know, in movies,
what do you
they're
mean,
the ultimate,
ultimate
victims.
Oh, yeah. I agree.
If it's going to move the man, it's going to be any assault on a woman. Think about King Kong.
Oh, yeah.
You know,
King Kong had correct. To get her.
They wanted to kill that monkey. Why? Because he wanted that white woman. Usually in movies, what they portray, everything is to save a white woman.
A damsel in distress.
Popeye, olive oil, you can save her no matter what. I'm going to eat my spinach and I'm going to go out here and I'm going to find her and I'm going to save her. So I looked at that as being that case. But it's really disheartening.
This is real life.
Yeah,
real life. Yeah,
Ellis. I just want to add two things to it.
Ellis,
I don't want to create a sweeping generalization. All white people don't get it. There was a young lady who videoed the stop. White girl who videoed the stop that happened with them.
Oh yes.
And she was afraid her boyfriend was gonna be shot. And the white officer said, "I don't shoot white people. I only shoot black people."
Right.
And that was
he was fired too.
He should have been, but they turned it in. Now the United Nations actually came out with an addendum.
United Nations is a joke.
Well, either way, they had to start somewhere. Denouncing the police brutality happening in the United States, it got started. So it has started on a world level, and that's exactly what happened with Birmingham when the two girls got bombed. It started on three girls. It started on a world level. It started at the UN. Keep in mind, they spent some things to take the attention off the UN measures, but yeah, they came out and denounced it. So right. It has started, Chris. It's not enough, fast enough. I totally agree with you. Every time a young black person dies, it definitely affects us because we see ourselves as dying.
You're right.
But you don't hear a lot reported on the UN investigating or the UN doing anything or saying anything in regards to it. And that's unfortunate. Yeah. But if you go back to what Chris said, you know, even when that officer pulled a person over and said, you know, we only shoot black people, and he probably was joking, and that's what he said. But the fact is, something was done about it. So he can joke about killing a black person and lose his job. But actually killing a black person gets you time off with pay and you get back to work. And that in itself is despicable.
Bankole says this: black boys should not be the exception to this country's universal conception that all are born free, equal, and in dignity and rights. And that's true. Why is that? It seems like these black young men are the exception to the rule.
Yeah, it's unfair. It's never going to be fair, and that's why Chris's passion, we all can relate to it. We all agree with it. It has to stop.
We have a call.
I think it also goes back to why you have Black Lives Matter, because as it's portrayed in all of these incidents, they don't matter,
right?
By the justice that's portrayed afterwards.
Right. Good morning, Gina.
Good morning.
Hi.
Yeah, I wanted to add into the conversation, and I see the emotion in all three of the young men there and yourself, and I as well. I can remember seeing Emmett Till in the Jet magazine when I was like a little kid, and it affected me to today. It basically changed my life, I kid you not. And to now be a grown woman and to see the same crap going on with kids, I could not believe as a child that somebody could do that to a little boy, okay? And now we still have it, starting with Trayvon Martin and on and on and on and on, and nothing has really changed. It really hasn't. It's just 2017 now instead of whenever Emmett Till was killed in the 50s or something, and it's just got to be something done about it, and it's got to be done by us. I understand white people control everything, and if we wait on them, it ain't going to happen, okay? It's just not going to happen. We have got to stand up against this stuff and do something about it. Now, this little boy that was just killed a couple of days ago, it's not even getting international attention, like, say, Trayvon Martin. It's like, okay, well, moving right along, another kid, black kid was killed. Even the people in Detroit and the surrounding areas are not really responding to it as they should. God darn it. It ought to be just overwhelming expression about this.
Absolutely.
People in the street and everywhere else, they're talking about studying it. That crap ought to be before the prosecutor, like right away, like they did when they beat that white man up down on the east side that time. They didn't waste no time dealing with him. He got all kind of compassion. You remember the white guy that got pulled out of his car and beat up by some black kids a couple of years back? I forgot his name. Okay, it had to do with something down there.
Yeah.
They did something over at the church too for him.
Can you speak up? I can't hear you. I'm sorry.
I said they did something over at the church for him, and I think at Reverend Holly's church, they had him come and his family come to try and make up for what had happened to him.
Well, I saw the candlelight vigil thing, and there was a little bit of disruption there. I'm talking about, this is going crazy. This is ridiculous. I am like the other young man over there saying, I'm sick and goddamn tired of this stuff. Now, enough is enough, and I don't care if every white person in the world don't care. I do. I've got sons. I've got grandchildren. I've got a husband. I've got brothers. I don't feel like waiting to see who's going to be on the news next if it's going to be one of mine. Okay.
Absolutely. That's the point.
People respond to it. It's just like, oh, well, he was probably doing something wrong anyway, or whatever else. They try to normalize this, and it is not normal.
Right.
This is my indication.
Right.
And thank you for that comment. My indicator for if white folks understand is, if you see it and you don't verbally say anything about it, you don't get it. Like, you can say, well, I felt bad. You don't get it. If you don't say something, if it doesn't cause you to move, change that potential to kinetic, then you don't get it. Because, I mean, what does it take? If you're, and I've got family that is of white and everything else. But if you're a white person and you see what's going on and a conversation comes up and you just sympathize internally, you don't get it.
Well, I'll say this, sir. It's not, and it might be that they don't get it, but some of them don't care.
Oh, for sure.
Because it doesn't hit them personally, and it's not going to happen. Their little sons can run around. Remember that little boy was walking around here open carrying a rifle? I think he was from Birmingham or some darn place. I don't know. He had a rifle out, and nobody, and he was bold with it. Like, basically challenging somebody to say something to him. Okay, you can go in any Walmart in some of these areas, and you can find white folks running around with guns, walking in Walmart with them. Okay, but let me or you do it.
Well, they showed, they showed last week what happened. The two white women in Walmart got in a fight, and one of the women pulled a gun. Wherein, what was it, a year or 2 years ago, that young man, he was playing with, he was an adult.
Yeah, he was looking at the gun.
He was looking at the gun at Walmart, and he ended up getting killed.
Yes, I remember. So, I mean, when is this going to end? I don't want my grandchildren sitting up talking about what happened, how they were impacted by Trayvon Martin, like I was Emmett Till. Enough of this doggone stuff. I am sick of it, and I don't know what it is about us, too. And I'm going to bring it out front here. I don't think we are reacting as we should, either. Now, back to the civil rights movement, when all of us were around, I think we all were around long enough to see some of it, if not the tail end of it or whatever. Black folks dealt with that stuff. And those three little girls got killed in that church. They dealt with that. They didn't sit back and say, oh, well, maybe white people ought to say something. Now, they got on that. And we got to get them off that thing. Like James Brown says, we got to stop dealing and stop being trying to intellectualize this, because you can't intellectualize ignorance. These are some ignorant, hateful, mean people out here now, on the police force and off of the police force. And Donald Trump has given them the green light. Go right ahead and do what the hell you want to do. And that's what they're doing. So if you don't push back, and I mean mass pushback, we're going to have more and more and more of this stuff.
Absolutely. Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you. We have another call. Good morning. Hello?
Yes.
Hello?
Yes. Good morning, Mrs. Pyramid Queen.
Good morning.
And good morning to your distinguished guests.
Good morning.
Good morning.
Three fine gentlemen. You know, this situation, understand, Queen, you know, a lot of times we don't really like to call a spade. And when we sit back and think about it, what we experience and what we see, we try to act like we don't see what we see. And when you think about it, you know, a lot of us are so cowardly within our own selves to see the way things are before our eyes. And when you think about, as you know, you're talking about, you're talking about officers have the audacity to roll a window down and to shoot a taser out the window and shoot a black kid. And like brothers are saying, you know, that would never happen in the white community. It would never happen like that. And for some reason, we allow it to happen amongst us. If you think about it, understand, here's an outstanding football player who's actually threw down by this little old Caucasian police officer and then put his knee in his back, put a gun up to his head and threatened to blow his brains out. When that brother is big enough and strong enough, he's an athlete, he's strong enough to probably tear that man apart with his bare hands. And you imagine, that's why the brother's so devastated, because now we look back, understand that poor Sister Bland, who's actually pulled over for no reason, and then she winds up dead in a cell saying, oh, she hung herself. And you imagine Demarion or whatever, the little brother
Demir
with a toy gun, they ride up on the side of him in a vehicle, right up on him, and blow him away. And we sit back as a people, and we be trying to justify it. And they go to court, and you look at the system itself, they go to court with a jury, and all of them walk free. But, you know, we won't call it for what it is. The American government has been a thorn in black people's side since they brought us here.
Well, they
and the government allows this to take place. They don't do anything about it. Because, Queen, we look at this, and regardless to what the verdict is, We know ain't nothing right about shooting a man with his hands up.
Absolutely.
Ain't nothing right with shooting a kid with a toy gun, and you know it's a toy gun. Ain't nothing right about it, Queen.
Right.
And we continue, but now all we got to do is keep living, Queen, and you're going to witness. We're witnessing God right now on America. You're watching these. Hurricanes, it's terrifying.
I was thinking about that. No, I was thinking.
Terrifying white people. You know, they've been white people been terrifying us since they brought us here.
Well.
And now you're witnessing, they're being terrified by God because he controls those hurricanes, whether we like it or not. And a lot of us understand we're not losing it because we don't have nothing.
Yeah.
Well, I thank you so much because
I thank you, Queen. I thank the three gentlemen with you. I love all of you.
Okay, love you too. Listen, I started thinking about that this morning. I said, things are happening all over. I said, could this be the wrath? No, seriously.
You know, and in all due fairness, I don't want to seem like the pendulum is just all one way. I feel like this. If a person gets in my car and my car is clean, pristine even, they're going to be less apt to defile it or to throw something down. But if they get in my car is filthy, they might. It's easier for them to throw. So this is what I want to. This is what I want to say when talking to black people now, because I got a problem with black people too. Like, they're mimicking what we do, right? We made drive-by shooting popular, right? Back in the early 90s and 80s, that was a thing, and we did that, right? So the rage, you know, they're just littering in a car that's already filthy, right? And it doesn't make it right, but they're mimicking what we do, and then we get more pissed when they do it. That's crazy, right? So the pendulum swings both ways. And I'm not talking about white people anymore or any less than I'm talking about the black people that sit there and cry foul when a cop shoot a kid, but you know, it's been a drive-by shooting, and there's no outrage.
And nobody saw it.
Correct.
And nobody saw it. Nobody's going to drop a dime. But we have to do something. This could be, I worry every time my son gets on the road, and he's 40 years old.
They're going to have to declare police shootings and the shootings as terrorism. So they'll be all over things if it's terrorism.
But yeah, it's not declared. Good point.
In other words, they've got to take it to another level because, listen, under President Obama, they named someone to be a czar, to be over all of this. What case came out of that?
Absolutely. Well, when they can take a guy like the football player and throw him down, put the knee in his back, they don't care who you are. You could be a doctor. You are Ellis Liddell. You own a building. They don't give a damn. You're black Ellis Liddell.
Absolutely. And trust me, like Chris, when I'm driving down the street and the police officers ride behind me, unfortunately, when he doesn't put his light on, I'm like Ice Cube. Today was a good day. And it shouldn't be that way. A good day because I didn't do nothing wrong.
Doesn't that guy work for you? Isn't he employed by your the years that I spent as a public servant taught me one thing, that if there's an officer or a firefighter or anything like that and they're out of order, your problem ain't with them. Let me speak to your officer, right? So who's the backstop? Forget these cops. These cops are peons, right? So you got to go above them. And it's not even their immediate supervisor. Who's the judge? Who is their chief? All of this stuff. We're looking at the perpetrator. We're looking at the child instead of looking at the parent. Check, you know. And so I think that the strategy, even of wanting the officer fired, you know what? They want to keep your job? Cool. You fired, though. You're fired. And I bet you that get more response than isolating this officer. Because I'm not going to check your child. But I will sue that. I'll get you.
Yeah, but you know, if you're stopped and you ask for that officer, oh, I want your badge number, you may not ever leave that stop. Yeah. Anyway.
Hey, you like solutions, so I'm going to give you one. Yeah. So here's a solution to our problem. If, for example, we declare that the next tax payment day, if a city has police brutality, we want their people not to pay their taxes that day. And if they hold their taxes, the worst case scenario is they get a 1% charge for paying late. But if they hold their taxes and they hold the city council accountable that's going to get more attention than anything else that we could talk about on this show or do. So that's an action step that actually
that is an action
gets their
step.
Attention. Because once a city can't pay those public service that Chris talked about, then they're going to get in line. So you're right. We have to be more action-oriented. And we'll just say now, we're planning for 2018. Let's become more action-oriented.
And I think you have to hold those judges and those prosecutors accountable, because right now they're finding ways to justify the unjustifiable. So you have a police officer that shoots a man in a car that did everything right by the book on video, and you still say, no, you know what? That was okay. I didn't see anything wrong with that.
Yeah, we're going to go back to Chris's circle in a second, because that breaks. Rodney King broke every black person heart around the person of color around the world.
You saw a man that was defenseless being beaten by multiple officers, screaming, saying, please stop. And
the only humane person was him.
They found him not guilty.
Right.
And they found a reason to justify it. Tamir Rice, they found a reason to justify it. Alton Sterling, they found a reason to justify it. I mean, each and every case, they find a reason to justify it. At some point, you have to stop and say, you know what? This is wrong. By the law, this is murder.
Absolutely. I just want to say this one thing before we I want to get to the football story, because it's a good story. But the one thing I do want to say is I close my eyes and I see Walter Scott being shot by running and being shot by a policeman. And I'm saying to myself, what is in this man's head that he has to shoot this guy? Where was he running?
And as a civilian with a CCW, you cannot shoot anyone running away from you. Mm-hmm. So how is it that as a police officer and you're trained and this is your job, that you're able to shoot someone that's running away from
in the back? I do want to go on to this story about Howard University and the historic win. Is that well, quickly, I'll take that other call quickly, but I have to get to this next story real. Good morning, Theo.
Good morning. Happy Friday to all of you.
Hi. Happy Friday to you.
I just wanted to say one recommendation is that the people in this community need to attend the police commission meetings. They also need to know that there is an agreement, unfortunately, between the chief of police, mayor, and whoever else, that it's okay for the state troopers to ride roughshod on the people in the city of Detroit. Also, the officers in Dearborn have an agreement with the Detroit police. They come in, they sit on the Detroit side, and watch the border, and they get ready to pounce on people.
When are those police?
They make plenty of money.
When are those commission meetings, Theo? When are the commission meetings?
Oh, every Thursday. The second Thursday, they're out in the community. But every Thursday at 3:00 on the third floor of the public safety building, which is on Third Avenue.
Thank you. That's what we needed to hear.
And I
give you the phone number.
I agree with
you. Can call for the community meeting 596-1830, and they'll tell us where they are moving to, so that people in the community after work can come.
No, we have
and
to
each
get
precinct
out
has
there.
A meeting as well.
We have to get out there. We have to be there. Thank you so much. I know Chris had something else to say.
Okay.
Thank you, Theo.
You're welcome, my name.
Those are called mutual aid agreements, right? And they happen in public safety. The only issue with just looking at that as a strategy is that we don't live in just Detroit. So the culture has to be attacked. It can't be, well, when we're safe in here, right? But when we go out, because at the end of the day, we got to leave Detroit, you know? And
absolutely.
So if they don't change the culture, the penalizing that goes along with this, it doesn't matter because you're eventually going to drive. What are you supposed to tiptoe? Because I remember as a kid doing that.
We tiptoed hitting, to Allen Park.
Yeah,
right,
when you cross 8 Mile or Evergreen or Coolidge, between 8 and 9 Mile.
Okay, all right, I know. Okay, good news story. Kaylin,
Newton.
Newton, yes. Cam Newton's brother.
HBCU.
Okay. Okay. Why don't you tell us? Tell us, because Howard was expected to lose by like 40
points. 40 points. If you bet $100 on Howard, you would have won $55,000.
If Howard would have took their...
I wish I would have bet on him.
If Howard would have took their earnings, which was $600,000, and bet on themselves... They'd have made millions of dollars.
New endowment.
So, I don't blame them for that one now. $100 is a little bit more feasible.
Tell the audience what happened.
But to paint the picture even better, Kalen Newton, who's Cam Newton's brother, chose Howard University before they knew we were going to get this coach who came along, who had been a coach in that division before. He was a white gentleman, and he came to the school, and he's going to coach this team back to an FCS championship. So he came with excitement. Newton got overlooked by a lot of schools in spite of his talent. So he ends up at Howard. The coach ends up at Howard. So you've got two people who believe in winning. And when you get two or more gathered in my name,
don't make it biblical, huh? Yeah. Biblical.
Who believe anything is possible. So Howard beats UNLV by 3 points, and they beat them handedly. Because they were supposed to lose by 40 points.
Beat the brakes off of.
And they had a chance to score again and just couldn't get it done.
And it's considered the greatest
upset.
Upset, that's the word. Upset in history at this point.
Of college football.
College football.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm. I was so excited about this. I just had to talk about it because this young man, how was he overlooked? What had happened?
He was undersized. He wasn't big like his brother.
Yeah, he's not as large as Cam Newton. But he's good.
How big?
He showed it.
How big is he? What is he, 5'7"? What?
I don't know.
No, you know, for quarterbacks, they like you to be 6'2", 6'5", things of that sort, so you can see over the defense. He's not that large. He might be my size. I'm 5'11".
He could be still growing.
Yeah, but he he showed him. It didn't matter the size of the package.
This weekend, I'll look to see if they're showing Howard playing somewhere just to see him in action, right?
Yeah.
And that's what's going to happen. So ESPN, all the media was talking about it. It's all the media hype. He's a darling of the media, and Howard is too.
He and the coach.
Absolutely.
Because to coach the greatest upset, especially when your team the previous years had lost by 40 points, to big schools like this, and to come out and compete, and not only compete but also to win, that's a great story. That's a great story.
When my son was in college, his first college basketball game was against Howard. They beat him. They beat Howard. But anyway, congratulations, and I just wish the best for him.
And I hope this is a message to a lot of other up-and-coming athletes that they do have a choice in regards to going back
and going to HBCU,
participating at HBCUs and actually winning and competing.
Oh, we're late. Everybody, thank you, gentlemen.
Thank you.
I'll see you again next week.